costume department is the biggest department in the Crown.
My favourite department is the costume department.
Ah, oh, Amy and Sid Buttons. Oh, they're so collaborative.
Mother and daughter, dream team. They've been my complete lifeline on the series.
Amy is extraordinary. Her daughter Sid, who I didn't actually realise until partway through filming, they're so fantastic to work with.
I've never spent more time on a job in costume. It was very much a collaboration, although Amy a lot of the time would say, just shut up and get on with it, you look marvellous, you know.
She is a real force to be reckoned with. She really brought her own artistic stamp to the Crown in season 3. And in season 4, she's really let go, and I think it's brilliant.
I knew what to expect the second time round. My work is better and bolder, perhaps, because I came to it with knowledge. You'd gone from season 1 and 2, those lovely muted palettes of war, post-war colours. So we had to really pull everybody into the 60s. So we went for big, sherbety colours, moving into the 80s now. And we're holding on to that colour, but you imagine it mixed a little bit muddier now. You've still got the tones of Elizabeth, quite clear and true, but just toned down.
Amy has a filmmaker's brain. She talks a lot about the emotional trajectory of the characters.
In our studio, we have a visual journey of each of our main characters with textiles of that period. You know, it's very stimulating. You're just in that world straight away.
You walk into Amy's office at Elstree and it's just photograph after photograph of Margaret Thatcher, who you start realising how well-dressed she was, in fact.
She was obsessed with clothes. There's a lot of letters that were sent back and forth between herself and her sister Muriel when she was in college, and it's all about clothes. She was always incredibly well put together and huge attention to detail. And that detail was absolutely carried out to a T by the team.
Whether you like her politics...
No.
Put all that to one side, she was quite phenomenal. Extraordinary outfits, hugely feminine.
I started filming with the famous Balmoral episodes and this fantastic, bright purple dress that Thatcher shows up for dinner at 6 p.m. when everybody is still in their shooting gear.
Your Majesty.
Down to this incredible blue suit that she shows up in at 7 o'clock in the morning to go stalking.
Say nothing. Prime Minister.
What a lovely morning.
Shall we?
Which then you see on this Scottish hillside, traipsing through in this blue in her hair. There is a definite trajectory that happens in her clothes.
Again, classic Thatcher. Previously, we've seen her with the Queen quite exposed. So now it's a different story. She wants to declare war.
And I say, we will not survive not going to war.
So all weakness is gone. Shoulders are still quite narrow, that wide look will come in later episodes. Both she and the Queen had Lorna bags. Hers is slightly bigger, more like a briefcase. We've gone for this very patriotic red, white and blue. This was a militaristic moment.
It's quite a costume.
Fashion is such an integral part of Dana's journey. She goes from being a very normal girl with, you know, very average, I think, taste in clothes.
This is the slightly more innocent Diana.
Your Royal Highness.
Who would wear bright woolen, almost home-knitted jumpers.
And then you've got her journey. She's pulled into the royal world and an increasingly toxic marriage.
And then, you know, by the end you leave her and she's really found her voice in her clothing.
This is the Diana that's becoming the Versace Diana, the fashion icon, the fashion goddess.
And that comes across in such a big way because I think she changed kind of the face of fashion.
What's interesting about her, I think, is your first image of her and your final image.
Emma, do you want a banana or something?
No, not in the dress.
That was fantastic. Sue, your heart rate must have gone through.
Love some Marmite toast, though. Yeah. Chocolate spread.
Yeah. The wedding dress, that took 14 weeks.
The fittings took a long time. Remember the first one, I kind of thought, should my mum be here? I was like, this is like a wedding dress fitting. This is mad. I might be the only one I do in my life.
Oh, amazing. I remember watching the wedding and thinking, ooh, that's a very big dress.
You think, oh my golly. What do I remember? What do you think about the sleeves, the bigness of that, and that huge, long, great train? That's what I have to achieve. The original lace that was made, which edged the dress and the train, was made in Nottingham, and we used the same company. And of course, it was the workroom that did all the work, with Sue and her team. It was weirdly exciting.
Okay, I'm happy.
I thought, I'm not going to cry, I'm not that sort of person. And I didn't, but I felt a bit weird. Every director that comes in, they're all so different, their take on things. And you know what they really feel strongly about. With Jess, she's very strong relationship with that journey with Princess Margaret.
We just talked about this late life bruising, what was happening to her.
I don't want more time. Don't you see?
It's just so beautiful when you go through the episode and you realise what Amy's done.
Margaret ages. She's having to battle with that and feeling unattractive and not successful in love, which doesn't help. Amy is very clever at working with colour and patterns.
Suddenly all these colours appear, which are very like a bruise deepening over time.
She's the wild card, isn't she? There's a terrific irritation about her, mixed with sadness. We highlight that with the tones of her being much darker than Series 3. Lovely, plain, dark skirt, and then that splash of anger. I don't know why, I just feel that sums her up.
Amy has that wonderful ability to look at character stories, where they are and where they're going to, and how can that costume represent that journey.
From season 3 to season 4, you've kind of seen what Anne had to be as a princess to her just taking her own life by the horns. You really, really see that in what she wears and how she chooses to present herself, I suppose.
The amount of, you know, audience scenes. How do you begin to choose the fabric and to juxtapose these women against each other?
We were trying to do how many costumes? I mean, thousands. You're covering all genres of life, big party events, New York, which is a different look, employment exchanges.
I've discovered recently how fashion can be like such a mode of expression and such a voice, in some senses such an armour.
It is quite overwhelming at times. As these stories come nearer and nearer to us now and people's memory, nothing prepared me for this world. It's phenomenal.